they are disliked by the community. So Jesus comes to his town, he wants to see Jesus. Jesus invited him to have a meal with him in his house, right? And the passage goes on. Now I want you to read this passage. All people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to the guest of, going to be a guest of a sinner. So Jesus is going to his house, he is considered to be a sinner, and people are saying that he is going to be a guest of a sinner.
Yes.
This is what Zacchaeus says. He says, but Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. So what did he do? He gave charity, so he gave his money to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. If I've cheated anybody, I'll give four times more money, right? Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to his house because this man too is a son of Abraham. So he's saying, I am the son of Abraham, but this man too is the son of Abraham. For the son of man came to seek and save the lost. So Jesus, the son of man, came to seek and save the lost. Now my question to you is, when Jesus told him that salvation is yours on that day, was he put on the cross by that time?
No.
No. So he was still alive, walking amongst the people. Yeah? He was walking amongst the people and he told this guy, salvation is yours based upon what did he do? Wealth and charity. And he said, I'll give you four times if I've wronged somebody. In other words, he sincerely asked forgiveness from Almighty God. He has undone the wrong he has done. Right? As a reward, Jesus is telling him, giving him glad tidings that salvation is yours. So this guy will be saved. Yes? My question to you is, if you can be saved by giving charity, believing that God Almighty will forgive you, right? Sincerely asking for forgiveness from Almighty God, why would you need this sacrificial system when Jesus himself is telling you that you don't need it? Who would you follow, Jesus or?
Jesus came down.
People commenting.
Was Zacchaeus forgiven on that day according to Jesus? Yes. And Jesus was still alive. So if you can be given by not believing he will die for your sins according to Jesus Christ, then why would you want to follow a concept you don't understand yourself? I believe in the Son of Man. I believe in Jesus Christ. You believe in Jesus Christ. This gentleman here, he believes in Jesus Christ.
I mean, the question is, do you need to believe in the crucifixion? That's the question. In order to be saved, do you need to believe in the crucifixion?
Jesus is saying no.
After Jesus was saved, that's, I know that they point toward the crucifixion, so it's not because everyone who was happened to be born before the crucifixion, oh, Jesus hadn't been crucified, they cannot be saved. Like, so that's not what I mean. But after it happened, so the crucifixion is kind of like, we know from that is what was happened for our sins. So I believe that he was following Jesus, that he had faith. And so I know he hasn't been crucified, but and he does what Jesus tells him to do, absolutely, and that is good. And I also see it as a sign of faith, not necessarily that is that in order to be saved, but that he actually believes Jesus when he said,
so let's see what over here. So he
your friend is busy anyway. She's busy.
No, I know, but that's because she's bad at saying no. Like I just know her.
She's stuck in.
Okay, that's fine.
So according to you, he believed in Jesus. He followed what he asked him to do, which is giving charity and basically telling people that we have wronged anybody, he will give four times his wealth.
Say he did it out of what someone else said to give away your possessions. It wasn't Jesus.
Can you just take me through what he did to get salvation? Let's go through what he did to get salvation. What did he do to get salvation? Or glad tidings of salvation.
Yes.
So, yes. So he has given charity and okay. Yeah, that's fine. And what else did he do to get salvation? Did he say, Jesus, I believe that you will die for my sin? No.
But he
then why would you have
that? That's not, because everything, this incident, neither does it say. You could say that, yeah, it doesn't say that Jesus died for your sins and that's why you're being saved, but it doesn't say directly either. So
no, but if it was quite important, then Jesus would have mentioned it, right? If it was one of the main things that you need to believe in order to be saved, then Jesus would have surely mentioned that.
Well, the only way to salvation, like you said, if that was the only way to salvation, don't you think he would have mentioned that poor guy who believed that he's saved now? I mean, for the rest of his life, he'll be jumping all over the place in Jerusalem, thinking that, or that town, thinking that he's saved because Jesus gave him glad tidings as a messenger of God. But suddenly, after 2,000 years, he'll find out in his grave that he had to believe that Jesus died for his sins. I mean, that's amazing, isn't it?
But we don't know what happened after. And you can pick out a lot of incidents like that. But
I can give you a few more.
I know from before this week, that was a long time before, the disciples didn't know what was going to happen to him. Yet they followed him.
Do you think that crucifixion is something that is just? I mean, imagine this. A person who has not committed a crime, like Jesus, who is sinless, yes? Who has got no, I mean, nothing basically to say that he deserves this kind of crucifixion,
yeah, he didn't,
or punishment, or whatever you want to call it. So why does God basically kill an innocent person for the sins of others? I mean, where is justice here? There's neither love. What? Did he kill himself? That's a suicide. That's a sin as well. Either way, it's bad, isn't it? If you commit suicide, it's one of the greatest sins, according to the Abrahamic faith, I think.
For all religions, and I believe Islam.
No, I mean, just want to understand what do you believe in, and how.
So in this case, God was being just in the sense that our sins were being redeemed. But yeah, it's not just that an innocent person actually.
Exactly, yeah. And it's the same in the Old Testament. It was the innocent animals who were killed for the sins of the other people who actually committed the sin. So in both cases, it is, I mean, I see it as A, unjust, and there's no love here. There's basically injustice and... If he really loves you, then he should be able to forgive you instead of asking or demanding the blood of innocents.
But God,
you see what I mean?
I see what you mean.
Yeah, because in Islam, you see, we have something called the concept of forgiveness. So you ask God for forgiveness for all the sins you have committed, and God, being merciful, is able to forgive you.
He's merciful, but he's not being just.
No, but you see, God's mercy and justice is up to him, not up to us. So it doesn't mean that every sin or every murderer who commits a sin, God will say, yes, you're forgiven. No, it's not automatic like that. It's up to him. Yes, he decides based on his wisdom.
You live in dread the entire life if you did something really wrong, and you're like, I don't know exactly.
No, no, God tells us what is wrong and what is not.
I know.
He does give us
a
guidance.
You did something. No, exactly the same, yeah. In the Bible, but you did something wrong, and like you said, you don't know exactly if he's going to forgive you on the day of judgment.
No, but why do you lose hope in God? You should always have hope in God. Why do you think that God will not forgive you if you have really, sincerely asked God for forgiveness and you have committed yourself not to commit that particular sin again? Why would God not forgive you?
What if you don't have the mental capacity to ask for forgiveness? But what if you do like a bad sin? Like you kill someone just before judgment day.
Or if you kill someone, then you have to pay for the consequence. You don't just get forgiven like that. God will obviously judge everyone in a just way. But what I don't see is that no way God will punish someone for the sin of another, because even in the Old Testament, if you go to Ezekiel 18, yes, it says the son is not accountable for the sins of the father, and the father is not accountable for the sins of the son. And to me, that is justice. And this is the Old Testament law. So I'm asking, in the New Testament, what happens? Why is it that God demands the blood of an innocent being like Jesus, yes, for the sins of the person who has committed murders or rapes or someone who has stolen or whatever they have done? It just doesn't seem to add up. The merciful God, who is able to forgive you, is now demanding the blood of a human being. How is that different to the Aztecs and the Incas, who basically sacrificed? They had a ritual of sacrificial ritual, yeah, where they used to atone for their sins or whatever bad deeds, or for getting a good harvest or whatever. They used to sacrifice human beings. Now, Christianity somehow is now saying, okay, it's okay to sacrifice this human being so that we all can be saved. It doesn't
not
add up.
A human being. This is God himself. So is our God?
If it is God,
asked to sacrifice some random. Plus, you wouldn't ever be able to find a sin-free human human being on Earth.
No, but if he was God, then can God die? You see, it gets worse. It just gets worse.
I accept that. It seems illogic. That's the thing.
No, no, it's not illogical. It goes against the Bible. According to the Bible, God is immortal. And if you're saying God died on the cross, then you're going against the Bible itself. So either way, it seems very bad. A, there's injustice being committed, where you kill an innocent man for the sins of others. B, you are now saying that he's God, and that gets even worse, because in 1 Timothy 6:16, it says he alone is immortal. You know what immortal means?
Yes.
It means someone who does not die. Someone who's not subject to death. Absolutely. Do you believe God is immortal? Because I believe he's immortal. So if we both agree on this, which is the principle in Abrahamic faith, I think in Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and also in other religions, that God is immortal, and we all are mortals. We all will die one day. In the Quran, Allah says, "Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut." Every person shall taste death. And this is true for every man, every animal, every bird out there, everything, you know. We all die one day. The only one who's ever living and always living, never to die, is God Almighty. But then you say God died on the cross by his own creation, which just seems ludicrous to me. I mean, God creates this. God creates this creation.
It's not new to me. It's not because I haven't thought of that until you guys.
So how do you reconcile it based on the Bible? How would you reconcile this?
And we could go on.
And that's
I'm happy
fine.
To come again.
Okay, no problem. I want to hold you against your will. She's no. Finally free. That's fine. Thanks for your time.
Thank you anyway. Sorry, I'm not very
No,
that's
Danish
fine.
And I'm not
You've been good. You've been.
You want some help from your friend?
You've done fine.
Oh, thank you.
Good.
I've never had so many. Just by one question.
You're on the whole
You're actually live. You're on live on YouTube now.
But I'm not like a good, I don't have the word.
No, you've been quite well. Thanks, guys.
All right, thank you. Bye.
Thanks for your time.